of this new world order. Just last month, I go to the land of liberty, fraternity, and equality. You know what country is that? What country? The land of liberty, fraternity, and equality. No, the French Revolution, France. That revolution that took place, this is for liberty, fraternity, and equality. For who? For who? For themselves. 1 million Algerians they killed before the Algerians got the freedom from the French. That liberty is for themselves. Fraternity is for themselves, that equality is for themselves. This is the hypocrisy of the West. For the America, everything that's American, suit them, that is law, that is hot, that is right. The French, the same. The British, the same. This is the sickness of the Western nations. They have a stick in the hand, and might is right. You got a stick in your hand? We are the same. That the person says, this buffalo is mine. The cow is a black animal. Buffalo. Buffalo is mine. So when you claim your buffalo, it's your buffalo, but I give you one stick on your head. So whose buffalo is it? He says, mine. I give you another one. So whose buffalo is this? You have this ankle, it's yours. It's the, right. The stick is in his hand, it's everything. Mine is right. So in this land of liberty, fraternity, and equality, I'm called on a lecture tour. On the 15th of September last month, I leave Durban. And on this morning of the 16th, I landed in London, and across the channel, the same morning, I'm in France. I arrived at Charles de Gaulle Airport. The immigration officer, he does things automatically. You know, he doesn't care. He sees, as soon as I present my passport, he takes my passport, he opens it, looks for the visa, looks for the visa. A valid visa given to me by the French Embassy in South Africa. Costing me 200 rands. The most expensive visa I ever had in my life. 200 rands for the visa. So, with a valid visa, the guy sees the visa, and on the opposite page is a blank page. So he stamps it. Charles de Gaulle Airport, 16 September. He's... Then he looks up to me. He sees this topi, and he sees this beard. And bells begin to ring in his head. Yeah, this is something strange. This is a strange creature has come into France. There are some 2 million Muslims there, mostly Arabs, from Morocco and from Algeria and from Jews. But generally they're all, you know, bareheaded. I mean, they have nothing on their heads. And they have no beards, they're clean shaven, but almost all of them. But here is a strange creature with something here to identify him as somebody. He stands for something, and I do. I believe in the principle that a label shows your intent, wear it. If your label, your identity shows what you stand for, wear it, unless your life is in danger. I believe in this, that this is my identity. I want the people to know I'm a Muslim. And this also shows us, look, there's a combination. I'm a Muslim. I wear this identity. He sees his identity, and lights begin to blink in his head. Said, this guy's an angel. So he types my name on the computer. And I appear. I can't see it, but I know what's going on. He sees my name, and he presses a button. I didn't see him pressing the button. But just within a few seconds, I see three guys, and behind him, over the shelf, they're looking on from the outside, that enclosure in which he's seated. And that may be curiosity among us. They just want to know what's going on there. Like there's nothing else to do. But no. They have a special branch, people, to hear now what's going on, what I'm going to say. 3 hours, they interrogated me. 3 hours. And they kept me for 11 hours before pushing me back to London. I said, I want to go to Saudi Arabia. There's a visa waiting for me at the Saudi embassy. Please let me go and get the visa and send me to Saudi Arabia. The ticket is here. I got a ticket for Saudi Arabia. I said, no. I said, look, send your police with me. So I go along and get the visa and come back. So no. So your son can go. I said, right. Let my son go and give him my passport. He said, no, you and your passport are inseparable. You got something to do. So passport must remain. I said, then how can I get the visa? Ultimately the first one came to London, and from London I got the visa to go to Saudi Arabia, and I made a trip.
them to put me on that danger list. What did I do
that I should deserve such an honor from the French door? I remember. You see, I have numerous books. I've written these booklets. They were available free here. If you haven't taken them on the way there, pick them up. You can pick them up. I have written books. Booklets, actually. What the Bible says about Muhammad, and I had it translated into French. Same book in French. Muhammad, the natural successor to Christ. I had it translated into French. Muhammad the greatest. Muhammad the greatest. I had translated into French. Al-Quran, the miracle of miracles. I had translated into French. And all my other little books, about 20 of them, 14 to 20 of them, we had them translated into French. But we have no market in South Africa for French books. So I'm trying to get through to France. And I managed to get a list of 300 Muslim names. Names and addresses of Muslims in France. So I post 300 parcels. And they go and land in France with a bag. They immigrate the customs. They notice it's identical parcels. 300 of them. What's going on? And they look closely at the parcels. It's Muslim, 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 Muslim. Every parcel is addressed to Muslims. So there's a conspiracy at work. There must be something here that the people are planning an overthrow of the French government. They think like 300 parcels, identical parcels, same size, and all addressed to Muslims. Naturally, the French became suspicious. So they started opening my books, start reading them. And they found something. They did find something. But this is the most dangerous book. Salman's Rushdie's satanic verses is translated into French. His kosher is halal. Ahmed Deedat's books are dangerous. A land of liberty, fraternity, equality. Double standards. This one here is a danger to France. What makes it a danger? They open up and they read. I'm quoting a Frenchman here, a French historian by the name of Lamartine. In 1854, about 150 years ago, this Frenchman wrote a book called The History of the Turks in French. And the Turks, incidentally being Muslims, he spoke something about our Nabi Karim, about the Holy Prophet. Speaking about our Nabi, he says in his book, Lamartine, which I quote here, in English as in French, speaks of us. Turks being Muslims, look, they follow the religion of Islam, and the Prophet is the Holy Prophet Muhammad. And this man Muhammad, what he has to say about him, he says, if greatness of purpose, smallness of means, and outstanding results are the three criteria of human genius, who could dare to compare any great man in modern history with Muhammad? He dares you to produce your candidate to compare with this man Muhammad. Greatness of purpose, what the man is out to do. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A reclamation of the whole of mankind. Saving them from idol worship, from adulteries, from drunkenness, from gambling, from racism, from reclamation of the whole of mankind, as Allah testifies. This is وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. So we have not sent you, Muhammad, except as a mercy to the whole of mankind. That's his greatness of purpose, what he's out to do, reclaim the whole of mankind. Smallness of means is what he starts. His capital, Muhammad's capital. Before he's born, his father dies. By the time he's six, his mother dies. He's doubly orphaned by the time he's six. Then 2 years, his grandfather looks after him, and he dies. Then he's looking after his uncle Abu Talib's goats. That's his capital. No royalty to back him up. No political party to back him up. With this, what he starts, smallness of means and outstanding results. 1,000,000,000 Muslims in the world today. The fastest growing religion on earth today is Islam. We are not so successful here, but overall in the world, in America, is the fastest growing religion. In Britain, is the fastest growing religion, Islam. Alhamdulillah. Outstanding results are the three criteria of human genius who could dare to compare any great man in modern history with Muhammad. He's daring you to produce your candidate to compare with this man Muhammad. There isn't anybody. And he ends his beautiful tribute by saying, our Nabi, philosopher, orator, apostle, legislator, warrior, conqueror of ideas, the restorer of rational beliefs, of a cult without images, the founder of 20 terrestrial empires and of one spiritual empire. That is Muhammad. With regards to all standards whereby human greatness may be measured, we may well ask, is there any man greater than he? Is there any man greater than he? The answer is in the question. The answer is reposing in the question. Meaning, no man greater than Muhammad, the greatest man that ever lived was Muhammad. And he is confirming what Allah says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ قُلُوبِ الْعَزِيمِ. Most certainly thou, Muhammad, standest on the highest pinnacle of behavior. And a Frenchman confirms it. This the French authorities couldn't digest, couldn't stomach. So all my books were returned. All the parcels came back. And you couldn't understand. Each and every parcel had a rubber stamp on. Unknown, unknown, unknown. 300 unknowns? How is it possible? Muhammad is the only thing I could say. And we couldn't understand what's the game. Who can we approach? Who can we talk to? Or how did this happen? That these parcels went out, posted, wasted, the thing comes back, unknown, 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 unknown. And we were reconciled. What to do? We had forgotten about it. Now, they see me in person. I get the visa, I inform the people that look, I'm coming on the 16th, I'm arriving, and you can hear any lectures. So the Muslims there, they went to the Ministry of Interior, got permission for my lecture. They got permission. It's like a police state. Unlike South Africa, alhamdulillah, look, we have a meeting. You don't have to go and ask the government. City Hall, Cape Town, we have a meeting, Greenpoint Drive. You don't have to get a prior permission from the government. You want to publish a book, you go and publish it. If somebody has objection, they can lodge it with the information, Department of Information. And if they think this is not worth, they'll call you up and tell you that this book is not right. And if you can defend yourself, you can defend your book. We had gone to court against the government, and alhamdulillah, we had won. We had won against the government. So they give you a fighting chance. With all this apartheid regime and injustices and all, they give you a freedom of speech, which is second to none in the world. We have to give credit. Second to none in the world. City Hall, Cape Town, I go and lecture there. Christianity, communism, or Islam? Which has the answers to the problems of South Africa? And no interference. Actually, from the title, you can see that the man is going to prove that Islam is the answer, not communism and not Christianity. Islam is the answer, but no interference from the government. This land of liberty, they give permission, the municipality give them permission for the hall, and they advertise. And somebody sees the advert, one who had been seeing the books. And immediately he activated the government to stop me from entering the country. Stop. And I was stopped. Double standards. Rushdie's book, satanic verses, is halal, is jais, is kosher. Ahmed Deedat books are dangerous, out of reach for the Muslim, for the people in France. Now, this reminded me that what is a nuclear power? France is a nuclear power with a nuclear bomb. That nuclear power gets shaken up by this old man with this beard and this topi. Huh? It's something strange. What is it? You think I'm that powerful? I'm that dangerous to a nuclear power? No. They had a valid reason. To me, they had a valid reason. I've been reading a book written by an American, Dr. Joseph Adam Pearson. He wrote a book on the life of one about our prophets. Worse than Christian. I didn't want to start making a big noise, making a propaganda. We make him famous. As Rushdie was made famous, people said, Rushdie, satanic verses. People said, let's see what the satanic verses is. He became a bestseller. I said, no, this hadith, you don't want to propagate him, Dr. Pearson, leave him alone. But in crap that he excretes in his book against the Nabi. There is a jewel. There is a diamond. Believe me, in that crap, in that filth, there is a jewel, a diamond. I found a diamond inside there, that rubbish. In that stinking stuff, I found a diamond. The diamond is that Dr. Pearson, he says, he said, people who worry about nuclear weaponry falling into the hands of the Arabs, the West is worried. He said, one day the Arabs will have the atom bomb. See, the Iraq was trying to get it. They allowed Israel to go knock it out. Libya, this is Libya might have it. Pakistan, they got an Islamic bomb, Pakistan. India has got it, it's okay. But Pakistan mustn't have it. Korea can have it, China can have it, Israel can have it, but Pakistan must not have it, Islamic bomb. Says one day, if this Arabs can't invent one, they might buy one from China, they might buy one from Korea. And they're worried about the illegitimate baby, Israel. That any Arab nation getting that bomb, there's only one thing that can be called, is Israel. And that's this illegitimate bastard child of America. That you can't tolerate. That, for that reason, Islamic bomb. So this American, he says, people who worry about nuclear weaponry falling into the hands of the Arabs fail to realize that the Islamic bomb has been dropped already. But the Islamic bomb has been dropped already. Now, I want to give a chance to my sisters. Tell me, where, when? This Quran is yours. First chance goes to my sisters. This American says that the Islamic bomb has been dropped already. That's in the past tense, huh? It's already dropped. Where, when? Come, my sisters. This book is yours. They are available there in the front. Those of you who haven't got a Quranic translation, I said, take one, they're 10 rands each, 2,000 pages, it's cheap, Allah is cheap. It's the best investment that you can ever make, this Quran. Everything on your fingertips, that index, everything, whatever you want to know on your fingertips, this book here, this is by Abdullah Yusuf Ali. If you have one, you don't need another. But to give a present for it, you know, birthday parties or wedding parties to the bride, to the groom, no better present than this Allah's Kalam. But now I want to give this to my sisters, and just tell me where and when. Yes, my sister. Huh? Makkah. Yes. Huh? Ikra. Come, you lose nothing.
14 years ago. It was already been dropped.
When and where did this bomb fall?
The birth of Muhammad. Was the birth of Nabi Muhammad.
This book is yours. When you going out time, you take this. He says, it fell the day Muhammad was born. She said, right. It fell the day Muhammad was born. The atom bomb of Islam fell the day Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. He is the Islamic bomb. We don't value him. We take him for granted. We read the Durood Sharif and Salami and all that, mashallah. But we don't realize the man's worth. The enemy, he realizes that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Islamic bomb. At the age of 40, he came to fruition. The first data material of that Islamic bomb started getting collected in the Quran. This book that he left behind is the data material of that Islamic bomb. And my sin is that out of those data material, I have been taking out verses, rays of light out of that, to write my books. This is the only thing I knew. Angry? Mm-hmm. The first book. What the Bible says about Muhammad. It starts inside. You take the booklet, it starts. This one starts with an ayah from the Quran. Bismillah. Qul ara'aytum in kana min 'indillah وكفرتم به وشهد شاهد من بني إسرائيل على مثله فآمن واستكبرتم إن الله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين. From Surah Ahqaf, chapter 46, verse 10, and the whole book is a commentary on that ayah. Is my commentary on that ayah. Next one, Muhammad, the natural successor to Christ. It starts, وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولِهِ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُ أَحْمَدَ. Another ray of light from the Quran, from that atom bomb, from that data material that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left. I just borrow a verse and I start my commentary. This is my commentary on that. This is what? Shaking the French and shaking the world actually. See, Muhammad the greatest starts. It starts with another ayah from the Quran. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. So most certainly thou, Muhammad, standest on the highest pinnacle of behavior. From Surah Al-Qalam, chapter 60, verse 4. And my commentary. This one here, Al-Quran, the miracle of miracles, it starts. قُلْ لَإِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ زَهِيرًا. Surah Bani Israel, chapter 17, verse 88. I start with that in my commentary. So this is more powerful than the atom bomb. The nuclear power gets shaken with this. See the logic of it, the logic of it. They can see that not just throwing mud at people, that you people are going to go to hell, you know, you people are bloody drunkards, you know, you are like this, you are already promiscuous, you got so many quarter million abortions a year taking place in your country, quarter million abortions, innocent children, defenseless children, you murder them, quarter million, nothing of that kind, nothing of that kind. We are only giving you a commentary of these Quranic ayahs from that atom bomb that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam left. Out of that rays of light are taken out and expanded, which makes it too hard for the French to swallow. Now, they are terrified. See, Islam is a challenge. George Bernard Shaw, a British playwright, he said, if any religion has a chance of conquering England, then Europe, within the next 100 years, that religion is Islam. Not with a gun, not with a grenade, but with the intellect. If any religion has a chance of conquering England, nay Europe, within the next 100 years, that religion is Islam. And they know. Islam is growing in Britain. And in France, there are 2 million Muslims there. And you have to talk to the people according to their background and experience. And to do that, before leaving for France, I learned French. It's a hobby. If I go to a new country, I try to learn the language of the people. I was wanting to go to Indonesia, so I learned Indonesian. And in the city hall of Cape Town, I was demonstrating to the people. I said, you see, every language is beautiful and every language is unique. But when we don't know a language, that language seems funny to us, silly to us. So I started telling the people, I said, now look, I want you people to vote for the silliest language that I'm going to speak. So saying, I said, look, I'm speaking English to you. You Malays are more bilingual than the Afrikaners. You know, you speak English as good as your Afrikaners. At home you speak Afrikaans like the Afrikaner, and with me you speak English as good as the Englishman. You are most bilingual people. So I'm speaking English. It sounds natural to you. If I speak Afrikaans, as a mar exagerated bar 8, did this for yellow 4 ek wechan, one does take as ni wechan ni. So you say, well, this has got some weird accent, you know, some funny way of saying things. But there's nothing funny about the language. There's nothing funny about the language. There's funny about my pronunciation, but nothing funny about the language. Then I quoted some verses in Zulu. They're used to listening to Xhosa. Xhosa and Zulu are sister languages, dialects of the same language. Again, it's not so funny. Then I quoted Swahili. It said, Tazameni mikono yangu na miguu yangu. Yagua imi mwende. Mshigini mshigini mwone. Wagua roho haina mwili na mifuka. Pupa. Kama navyo niona, mimi wanae. And there was a smile on the audience. So that sounds a little funny. Then I said, ten gofra, tanganku, dan kakiku, inila aku sendiri, jamahla aku dan lihatla, karena hantu tiada berdaging dan tulang, seperti yang kamu lihat pada padaku. And there was a laugh. So that means they voted. They voted already. I didn't have to ask. You voted that the silliest and the funniest language is this last one. So I'm asking my audience, in fact it's the simple fact, with mostly my Muslim brothers and sisters, mostly Malays. So I said, what language is that? They don't know. I said, that's your language. Damn fools, this is your language. Your language is the silliest and the funniest language? How can you say such a thing? No, the reason is, for 300 years we didn't hear it. And it's 10,000 miles away from here. So there's no chance of you just going to it. So that language, because you didn't hear, it sounds the silliest and the funniest. But if you were an Indonesian or a Malaysian, you say this is the sweetest language, tango, klap, tangan, gudan, kakiku. By God, you say so. That's the best. So now, I have this hobby of mine, I learn French. And that's the hardest language. By God. I know Spanish, I can give you Spanish. Hebrew, I can give you. Nigerian, I can give you. So many languages, about 20 different languages I can give you. But the hardest I found was French. You know, at this old age, wanting to learn a new words, you know, the pronunciation. And I forget. And again, I hammer the thing in, and again, it falls off in front of them. And it was ordeal. But I did it. I did it while I'm traveling from Durban to London, all the way. I was a super dumb Jew. Did I really care? Did I want to Jew? Pour vous que je parle, car si je ne parle pas, les conseillers ne viendront pas pour vous. Mais si je m'en vais, je vous l'enverrai. I did it. And still, it's getting on and on. I said, when I land in France, I'm going to tell these Muslims, I said, look, man, this old man, I took the trouble of learning this in French. Why can't you do the same? If this old man of 75 can do it, why can't you young people do the same? And this is, you're speaking the language. This is a foreign language to me. And it's a very difficult language, especially for those, I was told, if you know English first, then French is very difficult. If you just throw you into France, in the French environment, without knowing English, you can learn it quickly. But if you learn English first, because it's phonetic, it's a B-A-D bat, C-A-D cat, R-A-D rat, M-A-D mat, French is not like that. So, it's very difficult. I learned it. Now, in the second book of mine, Muhammad, the Natural Successor to Christ, I'm quoting an Afrikaans verse. It's in the English one. There's Afrikaans there. And it's a very, very beautiful way of starting with the Afrikaans, I found. I meet an African. I apologize to him. I says, you know, sir, I'm in South Africa for 60 years, and I can't speak Afrikaans. You know, I said, I feel very sorry. My apologies. I said, you see, the reason is, when I went to school, they didn't teach us Afrikaans at school, and that's a fact. But my children are doing very well. My children are learning Afrikaans. But you see, me, in my own way, I'm trying to learn the language. And you see, what I do is I use the Bible. I know the Bible extensively by heart in English. So if I want to learn another language, I get a Bible in that language. That's how I learned French. That's how I learned Indonesian. That's how I learned Swahili. I get a Bible in that language. So I learn Afrikaans, so I get an Afrikaans Bible. And what I already know, I memorize that. So I'm telling the African, I says, you know, your language is a unique language. Absolutely unique. Actually, all languages are unique, says the Quran. They are all signs of Allah's creation. Every language is miraculous and every language is unique. But yours is more special. It's the youngest of the world's languages, Afrikaans. And I said, it is absolutely unique. I said, you see, use four negatives to prove a positive.